At Desert Hope, we've continued to talk about what it looks like for us to be transformed as we follow Jesus daily, leading others to do the same thing. And this week, we're going to start a two-part message on this transformation idea. And Jesus tells us this idea of transformation. He uses the illustration of washing a bowl or washing a jar. It talks about the idea that if all you're going to do is wash the outside of the bowl or jar, you're probably not going to get the inside clean, because you can take the bowl or the jar and just dip it in the water, kind of scrub the outside, and it doesn't do anything to the inside, where it's probably the dirtiest. And so Jesus tells us, he says, wash the inside of the bowl or the jar first. That requires submerging the whole thing underwater. And in the process, as you're working on the inside and washing it, he says the outside is probably going to become clean too. And so this morning we're starting this two-part series, inward and outward, about transformation. What it looks like for us to live out the transformative love of Christ in our lives. But we're going to start with the inside. We're going to start on the inside of the vessel this morning. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for your love that is both shown to us by our moms, but that is also lavished out on our moms in our midst today. Thank you for your love that when we experience it, transforms us, changes everything about us. As we look at who you're calling us to be this morning, we ask that we would sit in the goodness and the perfectness of your love. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the things Pastor Jim tries to ask me to do is use pictures as much as I can. Help give us an idea of where we're going. I wish I could give you a picture this morning of where we're going, but I don't have the medical technology to get inside and look on the inside of you. You probably would be a little freaked out too if that's where we went this morning. I don't have a picture of where we're going this morning, because where we're going is for me to ask you just to press pause for a second and go inward, to think about the messages that you hear about yourself, to think about the messages that you tell yourself, to think about the messages that you allow yourself to believe about who you are. I want you to go inward and think about the person sitting here on your own from the inside. Who do I think I am? And I think one of the things I'm learning as I walk alongside a fantastic mom in this new parenting thing for both of us is how easy it is for our moms sometimes to get caught up in thinking that the message that they send the world is how much they get done, how much they accomplish. They're driven by this need to take care of other people and get things right. And I know one of the things I've been learning in conversation with Steph about what it looks like for her to be a mom is how easily it is for her to think she's not measuring up because she's measuring herself against other people. And how common it is for moms to sometimes think, I'm just not doing it enough. I need to do more. I need to be better at this. But this morning, we're not talking about the external stuff that we accomplish or get done. We're talking about what's inside, the message that you hear. And besides moms, we live in a society that's totally driven by resumes. What you can present to the world about what you've done, what your job is, and what you've accomplished. That's what our whole world tells us is what defines us. This morning, we hear something very different from Jesus. Remember, this is the second part of the passage that we read last week that Pastor Jim talked about remaining on the vine, being attached to the vine. The second half of this is Jesus says, remain in my love. The message that Jesus says to us is remain in my love. But I think sometimes when we talk about Jesus and when we hear this idea of abiding in his love or remaining in his love, we think that's the remainders. That's the leftovers. When I can get around to it, I'll try to remember that Jesus loves me. When I have time for it, I'll get to church on Sunday for an hour a week to hear that God loves me. Or maybe I'll try to get to a Bible study that will remind me that he loves me. But the idea, when Jesus says, remain in my love, it's not what's left over. The idea that we get from the text is, stay put. Stay right here. Don't move. Don't go anywhere. Be right here in my love. Don't come to me every once in a while just to get a pep talk and keep going. Stay firmly planted in my love. I know we all live crazy lives. There's all so much going on. In the midst of all the activity you do, remain in the love of Christ. Stay there. Don't let your feet move from it. Don't go looking for love from the world. Don't go looking for love from other people. Stay right in the love of Jesus. Well, what kind of love is the love of Jesus? And this is where Jesus takes us. In verse 9, he says, I have loved you just as the Father has loved me. Jesus says, I've loved you just as my Father has loved me. Not to go super theological on you, but Father, Son, Holy Spirit, three persons, one being in perfect harmony, perfect love, perfect holiness. I wish I could get anywhere close to describing that love for you. I can't even come within a universe of getting to the incredible nature of the love that the Father has for the Son. If I even tried to paint a picture or tell you a story of what this love would look like, it would probably come out sounding like two middle schoolers at the mall, a little excessive PDA, and you'd all probably try to gag. You're like, we don't need to go there. Think about the love that the Father has for the Son. Perfect love, complete love, whole love. And Jesus says, that's the kind of love I have for you. It's not a different one. It's not a lower level. The exact same kind of love that my Father has for me. We're one and the same. That's the kind of love I have for you. But then he also goes on to say, and it's the greatest kind of love. He says, no greater love can a man have than to lay his life down for his friends. You know what moms do? They lay their lives down for people. But you know what? Who showed us the greatest form of this? It's Jesus. He said, I am going to show you the greatest kind of love. It's a sacrificial love. It's the love where I give up my life to get yours. I give up my life in place of yours. Not because you earned it, not because you deserved it, not because you were good enough for it, not because I thought you had a better future than me, but because I loved you that much, I wanted to take your place. Jesus is the one that shows us the greatest kind of love. And we continue to try to demonstrate it in our world around us. But Jesus shows us the greatest kind of love. And so when he says, remain in my love, he talks about this perfect love that the Father has for the Son. He also talks about this idea that I love you enough to give up my own life for you. Stay there. Know that. Remain in my love to moms in the room. You don't need to work for this love. You don't need to think you need to be a better mom for this kind of loves. You don't think you need to do more, work more. He loves you fully and completely as you are. You can't do anything to change it. To everybody else in the room, same thing, okay? Good enough. Jesus goes on to talk about what it looks like to follow his commandments then, for us to be obedient to him because of the way he loves us. We're going to talk about that part next week. But he goes on to say this. he goes on to tell us about his love and how we can follow him. And next week we're going to look at, because of the inward message that I'm hearing, what does that mean about the way that I live outward in the world? We're going to talk about that. But what does it look like to remain in that love? How do we do it? There's one reason Pastor Jim continues to talk about and promote this soaping idea. And it's not so that you'll get puffed up with knowledge of Scripture. The idea that we want to get into Scripture every day. And it's not so that his job is going better. The idea that he wants us to soap isn't so that, you'll get brainwashed into thinking just like the pastor's here or something like that. The reason that Pastor Jim is so sold out on soaping, why he talks to us about it all the time, is because he wants you to hear every day that you are loved. And yes, when we're in Leviticus sometimes, you don't really sense that. But when we press pause on everything else going in life and we open our hearts and minds, say, God, I know that you love me and I'm going to spend some moments with you today. It changes everything when we start our days with the Word. Not because the Word has all the answers at an individual level each day, but because the practice of getting into the Word every day reminds us of who God is and shows us that he loves us on a regular basis. At the same time, my hope isn't that you come to Desert Hope on a regular basis so that you'll give us your money, or so that we don't have as many empty seats, or so that there won't be leftover chocolate chip cookies that I would eat, and I don't need any leftover chocolate chip cookies. Our hope that you'll be here and make it your home and your rhythm to be in this place every week is so that, again, you will hear that you're loved, so you'll remain in the love of God. Our hope is to see each other and remind each other that we're loved and that we get to love one another together. Not an attendance thing. It's who else in the world is going to tell you that you're loved just as you are? Same thing. We talk about growth groups in all different capacities at Desert Hope, but our hope is that we're getting together in smaller groups on a regular basis to grow in faith in God, but also to continue to remind each other over and over again that we're loved, that God loves us. What else do you need to hear this morning? Jesus goes on in this passage, says, remain in my love, stay here, stay put, don't move, just live out of this place of my love. But then he goes on to say, by the way, you're not just my servants anymore. I'm calling you my friends. I know this is a church that knows how to serve. We know what it means to get our hands dirty and work for the good of others. Work for the glory of God. You aren't just a servant. Jesus also calls you his friend. He says, you have been my servants. You're more than that. You are my friend. And I think one of the things that we hear internally sometimes from God is that, okay, as long as I do this thing to serve you, then you'll be happy with me. Then I'll grow in blessing or something like that. But I think sometimes we forget that Jesus says, you're my friend. I want to know you. I want to have conversations with you like I would with a friend. I want to know your hurts and your fears and your hopes and your dreams and your joys. I want to know all this stuff. Jesus doesn't just say, just do what I tell you to do. He says, talk to me. This is, I think, one of the scariest places as a pastor is to know that there are people that are sitting here this morning that believe that they're only servants, that believe they're only supposed to do stuff for God, that forget that God is calling them into a one-on-one individual friendship with himself. If you leave with nothing else this morning, I want you to hear it's not about what you can do for God. It's about a relationship with him that shares in the dynamics of who Jesus is. Letting him get to know all of you and getting to know all of him. Jesus hasn't just called you moms to service. Everybody else, he hasn't just called you to do stuff for him. He's called you his friend. Moms, remember that you have a friend with you in all of this. And everybody else, remember that you have a friend with you in all of this. Then Jesus says, and by the way, I'm giving you direct access through our relationship to the Father. Ask for whatever you want, and it will be given to you. The scary thing is when we start to think about what we actually ask for. Jesus says, you are loved, stay put. But not only are you loved, you're my friend. I want a relationship with you. And because of that, because you're loved, because of our friendship, I want you to ask for things. What are we asking for? Do we believe that the things that we ask for, God are actually going to give us? I know this much. The things that I've asked for in my life have been given to me in very unexpected packages usually. But I can't say that God hasn't answered when I've asked. And you know what? They've almost always been way better than I was, the thought I had in mind when I was asking. The wife that I started asking for probably when I was 10 and praying for, not that I was like girl crazy, I'm saying as a principal, my dad and I would pray for my future spouse. Is given to me in a way better and different package than I would have ever expected in my life. We have direct access through Jesus. What are we asking for? And I know how many parents are in here, and I'm learning what an incredible joy and privilege it is to be a parent. How cool it is. How the greatest thing in my life probably is just to experience the joy of my daughters. See them happy and carefree. It's so cool to see. And I know as a parent how much that defines you, taking care of other people, looking out for them, wanting their best interest. But Jesus in 1 John chapter 5 today reminds us that we're also children. Moms, you're also daughters. And I'm not talking about daughters of your biological parents. Everybody else in the room that's defined by this idea that you need to take care of other people, you are a child of the King. What that means is you can be helpless. You're allowed to be carefree. You're allowed to be joyful. You don't have to worry about all the things of parents. You can be a child of the King. He's watching out for you. Your first and foremost definition isn't a parent. Your first and foremost definition as a child of God. When you need things, go to Him. Embrace His joy. Don't worry about all the stuff. Live as a child. And then the last thing that Jesus says is, He says, by the way, all of you, my friends, the ones that I love, people that I call children, you didn't pick this. It's not your decision. I made the choice. I decided. I chose you. So I think sometimes we know our fickle natures. We know how much we can waffle back and forth on what we think of ourselves, the decisions we make to other people, our commitments. And so sometimes when we think about Jesus' love, when we think about who He's calling us to be, we think in the terms of our own thing, well, Jesus probably only loves me on Wednesdays because I'm hanging out with middle schoolers and He has to love me on Wednesdays. I hang out with high schoolers too. I don't know what that means. We think on conditions. But Jesus says, it's not about you and whether or not you're going to follow through, whether or not you're feeling it right now. I've chosen you. It's not your call on this one. You can't make me love you any more or any less. I did this. I chose you. Because He has told us to abide in His love, because He has called us friends, because He has called us His children, because He has told us He chose us. He says, experience my joy. It's hard to be joyful when I look at the stack of bills. It's hard to be joyful when I think about all the stuff that I'm failing at in my job. It's hard to be joyful when there's many girls crying all around me all the time. It's hard to be joyful when I think about the circumstances of my life. If I just look at them as circumstances. But when I think about the fact that I am loved that I'm a friend of Jesus, that I'm his kid, that he chose me, I well up with joy. What else do I have but joy? That the perfect God, whole God that doesn't need me, say, you're mine. You're my kid. Same thing for my daughter. She didn't pick, I picked her. I'm going to continue picking her. All the kids in the whole world, I'm picking her. And Jesus says the same thing, I picked you. He says, live in my joy. Moms, I get that life gets crazy. And your kids make you mad, disappoint you. Life gets hard. Moms, everybody else in the room, you are loved. Stay there. Don't say, well, when I have time, I'll get back to the leftovers. And I'll be reminded that Jesus loves me. Stay there. Know that you're loved. Stay put. Moms, know that you have a friend in this with you. It's about a relationship with Jesus. Moms, everybody else in the room, know that you're not defined just by titles or jobs. Parent, dad, mom. You're defined as a child of the King. Be carefree because of it. Be joyful because of it. When you think of all these things, experience and know the joy of Christ. He's picked you. One of the things I was in conversation with a family from our church about recently is how one of their grandkids has been diagnosed with failure to thrive. This idea that they don't get enough nourishment and they're just not growing like they should be. And there's all kinds of stuff that can be going on, but in the end, it's kind of a hard thing to figure out for medical practitioners. Why exactly does this happen? But I think not only can there be this physical condition where we're not getting enough nourishment, I think there can be a spiritual failure to thrive when we're not being nourished and being fed, thinking that all we are doing creatures or doing beings. My hope this morning as we looked inward is that whatever messages you're hearing or telling yourself, that you will be fed and nourished this morning, knowing that you are loved and that you're a friend of Jesus and that you're his child and that he picked you, but that you won't just leave here this morning, that you'll continue to remain in that love. I don't want us to be the kind of people, moms, I don't want you to think that you're the kind of person that is going to do stuff out of your drive to be loved, thinking that people love you because of what you accomplish. I'm hoping that everything that you do will be out of your knowledge that you are loved. Amen.